By 1536, Japan had been at war with itself for over 60 years as the Sengoku Jidai raged on, far and wide across the land. Samurai lords, both major and minor, had risen up to militarily challenge one another for control of feudal Japan's many provinces. And there was perhaps no more significant center for the ascension of clans that would become the most influential throughout the period than that in the east. It would be here we would see the growth of such names as the Takeda, Uesugi, Hojo, Oda, and Tokugawa. But the state of this region as we know it would evolve into in the later years of the era is much to the credit of arguably one of the greatest eastern families of the early Sengoku period, the Imagawa, who would come to be led by a brilliant figure by the name of Imagawa Yoshimoto, whose actions would lead the East into a new age of strength and stability, while also forging the Imagawa clan into not just one of the greatest powers in the region, but rather one of the greatest powers in the entire country. However, if you know even just a tiny bit about the history of feudal Japan, you probably know this man's fate. And you may even be surprised to hear anyone call him so much as brilliant. And I know Yoshimoto is someone I have touched on before in multiple videos, but I have always felt he deserved his own video, his own time in the spotlight. So that is what we are going to do here today, discuss the great lord of the East, and understand not only why he is one of the greatest figures of the Sengoku period, but also why Japan might have seen a very different future had he succeeded with his ultimate dream. Imagawa Yoshimoto was not at first necessarily destined for greatness. Born in 1519, he was the fifth son of Daimyo Imagawa Ujichika, a somewhat successful leader who had strengthened the family's position along the Tokaido, but would come to pass in 1526, leaving his young yet eldest son, Ujiteru, at the head of the family. Sitting at the base of Mount Fuji, the Imagawa domain was rich and plentiful, benefiting from their coastal positions and bustling trade along the busy highway that spanned through their land. At this point, following his brother's ascension to Lord of the Clan, the young Yoshimoto had been sent off to live a monastic life, a common practice for daimyo's siblings in feudal Japan. Yet, Ujiteru's reign would be a brief one, as just a decade later, he too would die. Yoshimoto's brother had passed away heirless in 1536, leaving a void at the head of the family that needed to be urgently filled. This would prompt Yoshimoto to emerge from his religious life, where he had taken the name Sengaku Shoho, or more commonly Baigaku Shoho, depending on how it is read. Yet he would not be the only one who would rise up to contest leadership of the Imagawa family, as his older half-brother, another monk by the name of Genko Itan, would return as well. With these two emerging to contend for the position as head of the Imagawa family, a civil war was imminent. Genko Itan would come to rally an army of his own at a place known as Hanakura. Thus, the ensuing clash would come to be known as the Hanakura no Ran. This had not been the first succession dispute the Imagawa clan had suffered, as the family had been plagued by them in the past. In fact, their father Ujichika had even created a set of house laws, or Imagawa code as it is sometimes described, to increase internal family stability and attempt to prevent such division. In the end, his work had not been entirely successful. But the importance of this struggle in particular would be who would win and the figures who would come to have a hand to play in the eventual victory of Imagawa Yoshimoto. Yoshimoto was the legitimate son of Ujichika and was backed by his influential mother, Jukei-ni, but was also supported by the strategically gifted Seisai Taigen, who had been the main guardian and educator of Yoshimoto from a very young age. But besides just having the backing of prominent figures within the clan, surrounding powers would also have their part to play in the conflict, as both Takeda Nobutora of Kai Province and Hojo Ujitsuna of Sagami would invest themselves into the support of Yoshimoto. Soon enough, Genko Itan was repelled, set upon, and forced to commit seppuku under the weight of Yoshimoto's forces and their allies. And it is really here that we can see that Yoshimoto was by no means a strong military figure, as it appears that the majority of his forces during the Hanakura no Ran were led by Seisai Taigen and others loyal to him. Either he was not comfortable with his own military leadership capabilities, or Taigen, who had tutored him for most of his life, was aware of his own skills and shortcomings. Whatever the case, by the end, the entirety of the rich Imagawa provinces of Suruga and Totomi would come to rest in the hands of Yoshimoto, who by this point had adopted the name we now know him as, changing it over from his old priesthood name of Baigaku Shoho, as he had been given permission from the shogun to use the Yoshi character, which he would incorporate into his own name. And this is where the great rule of Yoshimoto begins. Immediately, we start to see him strengthen bonds with those who had helped him secure leadership over the clan. In early 1537, Yoshimoto would be wed to the eldest daughter of Takeda Nobutora, forging a powerful alliance between the two families. But this came at a price, as their strong relationship was seen as a threat to the mighty Hojo clan of the East, as Hojo Ujitsuna would quickly launch an invasion into Suruga that Yoshimoto was unable to stop, resulting in the loss of some territory. And while Yoshimoto could have put his full attention on dealing with the Hojo, there were other pressing issues emerging to the west, as Oda Nobuhide of Owari was beginning to launch attacks into Mikawa, home of the weak Matsudaira family. It is here, faced with enemies to the east and west, and an ally to the north, that we see the development of a situation that can truly paint a solid picture of the man Yoshimoto was becoming. In 1540, Yoshimoto, it is believed, had been in contact with Takeda Nobutora's eldest son, Harunobu, Yoshimoto's brother-in-law and the future Takeda Shingen. Harunobu planned to usurp power away from his reckless father and build back the stability and strength of the Takeda family. It is here, if Yoshimoto wished, he could have certainly denied Harunobu and backed Nobutora, a move that could have kept the Takeda clan in a weaker state, and even opened up new flashpoints against the Hojo who might have tried to intervene as well. This could have even paved the way for the Imagawa to expand into Kai one day. But instead, Yoshimoto didn't. What he chose to do was rather to let the coup play out, and once Nobutora was exiled, grant him asylum. This worked to forge a stronger bond with his brother-in-law, the soon-to-be Takeda Shingen, the incoming head of the Takeda family. And with the Takeda entering into a new period of strength, so too were the Imagawa bolstered by their strong relationship. This would not be the last time that Yoshimoto would work diplomatically to forge stability in the East. In fact, it has been said that his diplomatic presence was one that would become very respected by his peers, as he would even be sought after to mediate negotiations and disputes. Yoshimoto was becoming an interesting figure whose own fascinations were unlike many of his contemporaries. Military conquest seemed to almost be placed in the backseat of his mind, while his real delights took center stage. He had a growing captivation with the imperial capital and imperial court politics, and it is clear that the prospect of being a member of the nobility was definitely seen by him as a defining character trait. As it is said, he began to dress like a court noble, while also shaving his eyebrows and blackening his teeth, trademark styles of feudal Japan's aristocracy. He even modeled his own capital in Sumpu after Kyoto itself, earning the nickname of being the Little Kyoto, with all the rich cultural influences that were reminiscent in the real capital. It's quite obvious that whatever ambitions Yoshimoto had, they did not rest with expansion eastward, but rather his real attention would be back west, towards Kyoto. And this is perhaps a large reason as to why by the early 1540s he did not turn his full attention to the threat on his doorstep that was the Hojo clan, but instead began to look further along the Tokaido, through Mikawa, Owari, and onward. Which is why, by 1542, he had begun to invest himself into a larger conflict against the hostile Oda clan, as both had begun to compete over the influence of Mikawa province. Now, in Mikawa itself sat the Matsudaira, unfortunately stuck between two much more powerful clans. However, while Oda Nobuhide had appeared as an aggressive invader, Imagawa Yoshimoto, on the other hand, appeared as more of a beacon of stability. This led Daimyo Matsudaira Hirotada into the open arms of the Imagawa. And although the combined forces of the Imagawa and Matsudaira were unable to defeat the Oda at the first battle of Azukizaka, their coalition remained intact. Years later, in 1548, Nobuhide would attack the Matsudaira power base at Okazaki, which prompted Hirotada to call upon the Imagawa once more. This time, however, in exchange for military aid, the Matsudaira were forced to fall almost entirely under the influence of Yoshimoto, as Hirotada's young son, Takechiyo, the future Tokugawa Ieyasu, would be handed over as a political hostage. Hirotada agreed, and with the aid of the Imagawa army, the Oda were soundly repelled. Yet, Takechiyo would never end up reaching Yoshimoto, as in 1549, forces loyal to Oda Nobuhide would ambush his guard and take him hostage back to Owari. He would remain with the Oda for 3 years, until finally being handed over to the Imagawa during a prisoner exchange. By this point, Imagawa Yoshimoto had assumed a commanding grip over Mikawa. Thus, the Imagawa clan had truly become one of the mightiest forces in the country, ruling over three prosperous provinces along the Tokaido. And as I have already expressed, not only did he control a powerful domain, but Yoshimoto had become a widely respected diplomat and mediator, not to mention a headstrong administrator of his own land. He had worked hard to strengthen the house rules of the Imagawa family that his father Ujichika had originally put together, building upon lasting internal stability within the Imagawa clan and provinces. But beyond that, Yoshimoto was blessed to have a powerful and exceptionally loyal military, led by the most competent of generals, with figures such as Seisai Taigen, Okabe Motonobu, Ii Naomori, and eventually the young Matsudaira Motonobu. By the mid-1550s, Yoshimoto had moved forward along with Taigen on a plan to unite the major powers of the East in a triple alliance. Through this, the Imagawa, Takeda, and Hojo would be joined together diplomatically by a series of marriages to ensure their combined unity. Nothing of this magnitude had ever been achieved before, at least during the Sengoku period. If successful, it would be a major achievement. And by 1554, the Kososun Sangoku Dome, the tripartite alliance of the three clans, was accomplished. This move effectively allowed each member to expand outward without worrying about threats from the rear. The Hojo were free to expand deeper into the Kanto region. Takeda Shingen was free to continue his northward push into Shinano and against the forces of Uesugi Kenshin. And Imagawa Yoshimoto was free to continue pushing west towards the capital. Now, it is easy to see that Yoshimoto's dream was to take Kyoto, but it is a bit harder to say actually why he wanted to. He was born of the Minamoto bloodline and could theoretically usurp the shogunate, but doing so might also antagonize countless other surrounding clans. What a safer bet might be was, though, due to his love of Kyoto politics and even culture, he perhaps may have wished to simply just champion the shogunate, dominating it with his own powerful influence, and even pushing towards the establishment of new peace and an end to the warring period. We have to remember that Yoshimoto was not a skilled military leader, and from what we know, he probably understood this himself. I have doubts that he actually would wish to become the new shogun. But oddly enough, the most interesting piece to this puzzle lays in action he had previously taken that went to distance himself and the Imagawa clan from the current Ashikaga shogunate, a move that made the Imagawa appear more independent in the grand scheme of things. We can use this development to justify either scenario, both with him entering the capital with the aim of becoming the new shogun, or entering the capital as an outside force to aid the shogunate, yet with no ties or obligations to it. Really, there is a lot to speculate on here. Now, 1 year after forming the tripartite alliance, Yoshimoto would sadly lose Seisai Taigen, who would pass away peacefully in 1555. This was without a doubt a crippling blow, as Seisai Taigen had been so instrumental in much of Yoshimoto's campaigns and diplomacy. but all hope was not necessarily lost. The Imagawa army was still massive and loyal to Yoshimoto. And with the rise of new competent commanders such as the young Matsudaira Motonobu, once again the future Tokugawa Ieyasu, the Imagawa were still very well off. And by 1560, Yoshimoto finally would launch the first leg of his legendary march westward, with the first obstacle being his old enemy, the Oda clan of Owari. The Oda were now mostly under the rule of a figure named Oda Nobunaga, the son of Nobuhide, who had died back in 1551. Nobunaga was by no means a respected leader, as many had heard tales of his strange antics and unorthodox behavior, dubbing him the Fool of Owari. But by 1560, he had mostly shaped up, as he had tried to piece the Oda family back together after the death of his father and subsequent splintering. Still, his forces were small compared to Yoshimoto's mighty host upon their invasion of Owari. Yet that didn't stop Nobunaga from achieving a staggeringly successful night attack against the Imagawa army at Okehazama, an attack that would leave Yoshimoto dead and his clan in ruins. Now, so many people like to put the blame squarely on Yoshimoto for this disastrous defeat, while others like to say that had Seisai Taigen been there, this would never have happened. But as I have said before, I do not believe that Yoshimoto's defeat at Okehazama to Oda Nobunaga is any fault of his own or any of the Imagawa generals. The success of Okehazama should be placed firmly on the unorthodox nature of Nobunaga, who was able to not only fool the Imagawa army into believing his forces were elsewhere, but then also launching a vicious surprise attack of the Imagawa encampment that no one suspected. It was simply an unthinkable thing that a force so small would sally out to catch the Imagawa army off guard. Don't blame Yoshimoto or any of the Imagawa high command for this. Simply praise Nobunaga for achieving it. Now, you probably know what happens from here. Nobunaga continues on in Yoshimoto's footsteps and eventually seizes the capital himself, and so on and so forth. While the Imagawa, now under the leadership of Yoshimoto's inexperienced son, Ujizane, fade away until they are ultimately destroyed years later. Spanning from Yoshimoto's defeat at Okehazama in 1560, all the way through the rest of the period, are decades of more conflict and strife, not to mention extended upon, largely thanks to the betrayal that would come to leave Nobunaga dead roughly 22 years later. This then begs the question, would the situation have been different had Yoshimoto been successful? Honestly, it is impossible to say, and all we can do is look at how he ruled throughout his life and guess at what might have been the case. Personally, I am one to believe that an Imagawa regime in control of Kyoto would have been incredibly powerful and could have definitely ended the Sengoku Jidai decades sooner, in large part thanks to not only being a mighty force themselves, but also through their continued alliances with the powerful Takeda and Hojo, who could have aided in pacifying the rest of Japan. Not to mention the fact that Yoshimoto was a highly respected figure who excelled at politics, diplomacy, and forging alliances. Sure, once again, Seisai Taigen was a large part of Yoshimoto's skill in that regard as well, but not all of Yoshimoto's diplomatic success was aided by Seisai Taigen. The important thing to remember was that Yoshimoto understood his own shortcomings and put others in place who did have the proper skill to excel and accomplish things. For the most part, he was a solid judge of character who knew how to staff his council and listen to their advice. The real, level-headed figure of Yoshimoto is a far cry from the buffoon he is often depicted as in popular media, and although he had great ambitions, they never became delusions of grandeur, as his goals were certainly obtainable. The purpose of this video is to help you think more critically about a figure who often gets either glossed over or cartoonishly portrayed thanks to his major defeat. But it is important to remember how powerful, respected, and capable he really was. So much so that even after he was slain on the field at Okehazama, loyal soldiers under the command of Okabe Motonobu would fight through the Oda forces to recover his body. Thank you for watching, and don't forget to like, subscribe, and ring that notification bell if you enjoyed this video and found it to be most interesting.